Welcome to Adventist Fact Check. I'm Colleen Tinker, and we are going through the Sabbath School lessons for the second quarter of 2024. The quarterly's title is The Great Controversy, and today's lesson, the fourth week, is entitled Standing for the Truth. Now, anybody who's been Adventist knows that the truth is code for Adventism. Now, that's not specifically what it means in this lesson, but it all leads there. Before we launch into the discussion of this lesson with my three points that I've selected for examination, I want to give a little bit of a backstory that I just learned this week. I heard Mark Finley do an introduction to this quarterly, and he was saying that the years 2024 and 2025 have been selected to be a special mission of delivering, as he put it, millions and millions of copies, hard copies, and online electronic copies of The Great Controversy around the world in various languages. Now, I have a little clip of Mark Finley describing this project and Ted Wilson's request to him that he write this. We'll watch that right now, and then we'll launch into the lesson.
This, in 2024 and 2025, Seventh-day Adventists have a massive project of distributing the book, The Great Controversy by Ellen White. There'll be millions and millions distributed. There will be hard copies in the full edition. There will be online editions. And I was asked to prepare the Sabbath School lessons based on the book Great Controversy, but anchored in Scripture. So every lesson is biblical. Every lesson has its foundation in Scripture. But something unique that we've done with this quarter's lessons is we have listed the chapters from Great Controversy that that biblical lesson is based on. So it is a very unique series. I have to smile a little bit. You know, I've written now, this is my fifth Sabbath School quarterly, and the General Conference President, Elder Wilson, called me, and he said, Mark, I've got an assignment, but it's kind of an interesting one. I said, yes, Elder, tell me. He said, well, the timeline is quite short, because usually we have 2 years, 2.5 years to write the lessons. And he said, Mark, we got about 3 months, but we need a series on the Great Controversy. Can you write it for us? Well, you know, it takes about 15 hours a lesson, about 200 hours to write it. And I didn't have that time just sitting around. But when my dear friend Elder Wilson asks me for something like that, and I put everything else aside, basically, and wrote the series on the Great Controversy in about 3 months of time. And so I'm just so thankful for that privilege, because it is such a vital, vital scene, particularly for those of us that are living in the last days at end time, because prophecies are being fulfilled all around us that we find outlined in the Great Controversy.
So what we are getting in this quarter's lesson series is Adventism's focus on equipping every one of its members to know the essentials of the Great Controversy and the Adventist worldview so they can help their neighbors understand it when their neighbors receive their books. Now, let's proceed into discussing lesson four. As usual, I've selected 3 points from this lesson which bear some looking at, and here they are. The first one is, this lesson establishes Adventism's day-for-a-year prophetic time principle. Number two, this lesson applies texts to Adventism that actually indict Adventism's false doctrines. And three, the author ignores Ellen White's misteaching about the Waldenses and uses them as contributing to the ethos that impelled Adventism in the 1800s. Now let's go through these things. Adventism, based on Ellen White's book, The Great Controversy, has always seen itself as the inheritor of the Reformation. Adventists believe that they have continued the reforms and the restorations that the reformers began but did not complete, Primary among these failed reforms or incomplete reforms has been the restoration of the knowledge of the seventh-day Sabbath and the second coming of Christ. Now, the irony of this is that the true body of Christ, the Christian church, which began on the day of Pentecost 2,000 years ago, has never been without a doctrine of Sabbath in Christ. And it's never lost the knowledge that Christ is returning. So for Adventism, which sprang up in the 1800s and by its own definition is the last day church with a last day message for the world, restoring what has been lost, that whole idea is false. Furthermore, Jesus himself said the gates of hell would not prevail against his church. No truth about Jesus, about salvation, about what he intends has ever been lost from his body of Christ. Now, to be sure, there have been times of greater spiritual darkness in the world. There have been times when the church did not seem to flourish as openly. But the people of God have never been without the knowledge of God. So for Adventism to say that they're restoring what has been lost is a self-aggrandizing misstatement. But be that as it may, that's what they claim for themselves. So in the Great Controversy, Ellen White has set up a paradigm by which she explains how they, the Adventists, fit into the timeline of the church and the Reformation. This week's lesson takes us right into their unique interpretation of prophetic time periods so that we see Adventism coming right out of the Reformation, and the reader is led from the formation of the church right up into William Miller's failed prophecy and into the formation of Adventism. And by looking at this through the lens of Ellen White and her strange time prophecies, why, it all makes sense. Except that when you look at it closely, it doesn't. Well, what is this strange time prophecy that Ellen White teaches in The Great Controversy? So at the heart of this unique time frame that we find in Ellen White's book, The Great Controversy, is something that she calls, and that the Adventist organization calls, the year for a day principle. Sunday's lesson launches us right into understanding this principle. Now, it's not an easy thing. I will tell you right up front, in Adventist schools as a kid, I had to learn the prophetic time charts of Adventism. I had to learn the day-year principle. And I passed the tests and I could fill out the charts, but to be honest, all of it always left me a little bit confused. So we will do our best to walk through what Mark Finley explains to us. Now, his version in Sunday's lesson is very truncated. It's only one day's one-page lesson, and a whole concept of day for a year is condensed down into that one lesson. So let's see if we can make some sense of what Mark Finley tells us. This day's lesson begins with Mark Finley giving us the command to read Daniel 7, 23 to 25 and Revelation 12, 6 and 14. And then he asks this, what prophetic time periods are referred to in these passages? Well, if any of you have been going through the former Adventist podcasts with Nikki Stevenson and me, you will know that we have gone through the book of Daniel, and we are currently going through Revelation. If we go back and read, as Mark Finley suggested that we do, Daniel 7, 23 to 25, and Revelation 12, 6 and 14, we see that in context, Daniel 7 is a description of that fourth terrible nondescript beast that Daniel saw in his vision of the beasts, representing the empires of the Gentile nations that would have dominion over God's people Israel until the end, when God himself would come and destroy them. This fourth beast immediately follows the kingdom of Greece, and we understand that Rome was the kingdom that followed Greece. So what we see is this fourth beast, which does not end until God himself comes down and destroys him. In fact, we find in Daniel 7:27 that God comes and gives the kingdoms of the whole world over to the saints of the highest one to rule over, and that is when this beast is destroyed. Furthermore, Daniel 7:25 is important for this lesson because it says this: He will speak words against the Most High and wear down the saints of the Highest One, and he will intend to make changes in seasons and in law, and they will be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time. That's Daniel 7:25. Now that's very important because that time, times, and half a time is going to be repeated in Revelation, and that is a significant way of measuring prophetic time, and we'll see what Adventism does with that measurement. Now we see that this same cruel political power which Daniel sees in his vision, which is limited to a time, times, and half a time, we see that again described in Revelation 12, 6, and 14. Notice that the details are different, the descriptions are a little different, but they're bound by the same time period. Here's what Revelation 12, 6, and 14 say. Then the woman fled into the wilderness where she had a place prepared by God, so that there she would be nourished for 1,260 days. But the two wings of the great eagle were given to the woman, so that she could fly into the wilderness to her place, where she was nourished for a time and times and half a time from the presence of the serpent. And again, that's Revelation 12, 6 and 14. So we see here that Revelation and Daniel are both describing the persecution of God's people and God's protection of them. And both of these visions are describing these times of persecution using the same time frames. Both of them, these two visions separated by hundreds of years, are describing these times of cruel persecution, but that they only are given a time frame of a time, times, and half a time for their duration. We also see that in Revelation, this time, times, and half a time is also equated to another number, 1,260 days. Now, if you think about it, and if you look at a lunar calendar, which is what both Daniel and John had, a year at that time under their calendar had 360 days. So we see that 1,260 days equals 3.5 years, a time, times, and half a time, 3.5 years. Now there's more to that. We can say more about how that time period is figured, and that's available if you do your research. It's available in our former Adventist podcasts on the subject. But it's also a fact that for theologians who know the Hebrew and the Greek, they all agree that time, times, and half a time refer to 3.5 years. Now, in this lesson, on Sunday's lesson, Mark Finley develops the Adventist explanation that the woman described in Revelation 12 is the church fleeing into the wilderness. In context, however, the woman is established as Israel. We see in the first part of Revelation 12 that there's a woman that John sees in a vision who's wearing 12 stars on her head, and she has the sun as clothing and the moon under her feet, and she's about to give birth, and the dragon is at her feet waiting to devour her child. But her child is caught up to heaven and escapes being devoured by the dragon. Theologians for years, theologians everywhere, see and agree that that woman represents Israel who's about to give birth to the Messiah. We can't take that view of that woman and then 6 verses later say that that woman who is Israel is now the church. It doesn't fit. But that's what Ellen White says, and that's what Mark Finley tells us. After he makes that assertion, Finley then does correctly, according to theologians, all places, he does correctly equate the reference to 1,260 days to 3.5 years. So far, so good. But then his explanations become quite confusing. And it's not surprising. He's merely explaining Ellen White's redefinition of this time frame into a year for a day principle. Now, here's what Finley says. Biblical prophecy is often written in symbols. In the prophetic portions of Daniel and Revelation, one prophetic day equals one literal year. We find this day-year principle in Numbers 14:34 and Ezekiel 4:6. The day-year principle rests not on these two texts only, but on a broad scriptural foundation. William Shea, chronologist and Old Testament scholar, gives 23 lines of biblical evidence throughout the Old Testament for this principle. Bible interpreters have used it throughout the centuries. The Visigoths, Vandals, and Ostrogoths were tribes that believed doctrines differently than Rome's official teaching. The 1260 days began when the last of these barbarian tribes, the Ostrogoths, were driven out of Rome in AD 538. This period of spiritual darkness continued until AD 1798, when the Napoleon's general Berthier removed the Pope from Rome. Countless Christians were martyred during this long period because they obeyed the word of God. Well, while there are many details that Daniel and Revelation do not tell us about this particular period of 3.5 years or 1260 days, these two books, in context, are very clear that this time period defines a terrible tribulation that will come upon God's people right before the Lord Jesus comes to reign on the earth. There's no sense in the Bible at all of this time period of 3.5 years or 1260 days representing the Middle Ages or representing anything starting in 538 AD and not ending until 1798. That's just not there if you read the Bible. Furthermore, the texts that Finley mentioned, Numbers 14:34 and Ezekiel 4:6, which Ellen White tells us about as supporting a supposed day-year principle, have nothing to do with establishing a new way of counting time. These two texts are simply describing accounts from Israel's history. Now, we're not going to read them, but I'll summarize them. Numbers 14:34 tells the story of when God came down and told Moses to let Israel know he was going to punish them for their unbelief when they didn't go in and take the land, when they first sent the spies into Canaan. You remember the story. Israel was camped in the wilderness, and God said, send 12 men into Canaan and bring back a report. 10 of the 12 came back and said, no, there's giants in the land. We can't go in. We're grasshoppers beside them. We will fail. We'll be killed. Our children will be taken hostage. Only Caleb and Joshua came back and said, God has this. We can do it under God. But 10 of those 12 were unbelieving and afraid. And Israel went with the 10. And God said, because of the unbelief, I am going to cause you to wander in the wilderness for 40 years, 1 year for every day the spies went on their reconnaissance mission into Canaan. Your children, whom you said would be taken captive, will be the ones who will actually go in and inhabit the land. You can see, that's not establishing a principle of day for a year in prophetic literature. It's simply the way God dealt with Israel, and he gave them 1 year of wandering in the wilderness for every day of their unbelief. Now, the passage in Ezekiel 4:6 is a very different scene, but it uses the idea of days and years in a similar way. In this passage, God is giving Ezekiel a very difficult and strange assignment. Ezekiel wrote, during the time of the exile of Judah into Babylon. It was a terribly difficult and troubled time in Israel's history, and Ezekiel was given some very difficult prophecies, and this particular one he had to act out. In this prophecy, God told Ezekiel that he was to act out his, God's, punishment of Israel and Judah for their iniquity. Ezekiel, oddly enough, was to lie on his left side and bear Israel's iniquity for the number of days that you lie on it. Now God said to him, I have set a number of days for you corresponding to the years of their iniquity, 390 days. And Ezekiel was then to lie on his right side for 40 days, bearing the iniquity of Judah, a day for each year. That was God's assignment to Ezekiel. It was a one-time, as we might say, unrepeatable event. It was a prophecy given specifically to Ezekiel for that period of time, and it was not establishing a way of interpreting prophetic literature. It was simply a command for Ezekiel to live out one day for every year of Israel's apostasy. Now, interestingly, the two examples here are exactly opposite. Israel had to live out a year for every day that those spies were in the land. Ezekiel had to live out a day for every year that Israel was in iniquity. But those little details are kind of not noticed when establishing these two texts as central passages to justify a day for a year principle. But we can see they have nothing to do with interpreting prophetic literature, a day for a year. Now, Finley does admit that there are other things that contribute to giving Adventists this right to interpret a day for a year. One of the things Finley does is he mentions a man named William Shea, the chronologist and Old Testament scholar, as a source of 23 lines of evidence to support this principle of day for a year prophecy. And it sounds authoritative. It sounds like, well, this isn't unique to Ellen White. And I'll admit, perhaps it wasn't completely unique to Ellen White, but it seems to be more of an anomaly than a normal way of looking at prophecy, and we'll see some of those evidences. There is a Wikipedia entry, and I know Wikipedia is not the die-all, end-all, be-all for definitions of history, but this is a very interesting entry. It's an entry on the day for a year principle, and I want to read it because it's very telling. It says this: the day for a year principle is used principally by the historicist school of prophetic interpretation. It is held by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Jehovah's Witnesses, and the Christadelphians. The day-year principle is also used by the Baha'i faith, as well as by most all astrologers who employ the secondary progression theory, aka the day-for-a-year theory, wherein the planets are moved forwards in the table of planetary motion known as ephemeris, a day for each year of life or fraction thereof. Now, what's so interesting here is that today, almost no Christians use the historicist principle of interpretation because historically, it really doesn't make sense. Furthermore, the William Shea, whom Finley quotes, is an Adventist. You might have guessed it. He is now dead, but he was a graduate of the Adventist Seminary at Andrews University, and he is the one who wrote Adventism's most definitive work on the day for a year principle, using some sort of references that he developed and made a point to teach everybody. I also learned that Jerry Moon, who is at the seminary of Andrews University, also wrote a paper on the day for a year principle in which he also cites this William Shea. But I was not able to discover any other Christian expositors who hold to a day for a year principle of interpreting prophecy. So all to say, it's dealt with very quickly in one day's lesson, very briefly, and Finley presents it to an audience that's already predisposed to believe it. He doesn't give a lot of good proof, but he gives some references that Adventists will have an echo of in their own minds because they know that their prophetic viewpoint is based on this. Now, another thing this lesson deals with is the idea of the Waldenses. Now, this is an interesting situation. The Waldenses lived during the medieval period. They formulated themselves into a group in the 12th century. Now, in The Great Controversy, Ellen White famously wrote about the Waldenses, calling them Christians who were observers of the seventh-day Sabbath. She wrote that they kept the true Sabbath. They had to hide in the mountains to save their lives because the Catholics wanted to kill them for their adherence to the seventh-day Sabbath. Now, it's been discovered, and it's a matter of historical record at this point, that the Waldenses did not keep the seventh-day Sabbath. But Ellen White wrote that they did, and she taught generations of Adventists that they did. I grew up with books in our family's library for both adults and children telling the stories of the Waldenses hiding for their lives. Mark Finley does bring them up. How could he not? He now refers to them in a brief mention in one day's lesson. He mentions that they were being persecuted for their adherence to the Word of God. Now, that much is true. Here is what the website gotquestions.org says about the Waldenses. And I'm reading this because there are many people who have been Adventist who just might come across this video who don't really know who the Waldenses were, except for what Ellen White said. But here is a bit of historical background. In 1487, Pope Innocent VIII pronounced a crusade against two Waldensian groups in the Cotian Alps along the French-Italian border, and many villages were devastated. The towns were destroyed, the women were raped, and about 4,000 people killed. In response to such severe persecution, many Waldensians fled to Geneva, Switzerland, where they found refuge with John Calvin. Eventually, most Waldensians became part of the churches of the Reformation, such as Presbyterian, Lutheran, or Reformed. But today, there are still Waldensian churches in existence in Germany, Italy, Uruguay, Argentina, the United States, and elsewhere. What's so interesting to me is not only were the Waldensians not Seventh-day Sabbath keepers, as Ellen White infamously said, but that ultimately, after 300 years of persecution, most of those Waldenses ended up becoming members of churches of the Reformation, which have always had strong practices of worshiping together on Sunday. Isn't that ironic? That's not what Ellen White said. But Mark Finley knows enough to know that he can't present them as Sabbath keepers, but he does present them as people who lost their lives for the sake of the Bible. This is just one more example of Adventism's quietly coming along, suppressing the embarrassing evidence that Ellen White did not get her revelations from God, that she wrote error, that she taught error, and that Adventists have understood error for decades and, well, actually, since she lived over a century and a half ago. Finally, we're going to look at a few other texts that this lesson has badly misused. And I have to mention this because this is one more example of how Adventism appropriates biblical texts to describe themselves. And this whole thing is premised on the idea that the readers who are Adventists will be reading these texts from inside the worldview of the Great Controversy. Remember, a couple weeks ago, we talked about the fact that the lens of Adventism is invisible to an Adventist. The Ellen White interpretation of Scripture is a grid through which they see all of reality and all of the Bible. And most Adventists are unaware that they're seeing the Bible through this grid. Here are some great examples of this. In Monday's lesson, Finley asks us to read Jude 3 and 4. And then the question is asked, what's the warning here? And how did it apply to the later Christian church? Well, Jude, as you might recall, is the tiny little book, one chapter long, right before the book of Revelation, that was written by one of Jesus' half-brothers who did not believe in Jesus during his lifetime, but he believed after the resurrection, and his book is included in the New Testament canon. Here is what Jude 3 and 4 says. "Beloved, while I was making every effort to write to you about our common salvation, I felt the necessity to write to you exhorting that you contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all handed down to the saints. For certain persons have crept in unnoticed, those who were long beforehand marked out for this condemnation, ungodly persons who turn the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ." Well, contextually, this passage is a warning against the deceptive teachings of false teachers that will enter in and deceive Christians. This text is a text that warns us about Adventism. In fact, Adventists are often embraced in the Christian community as fellow believers because they're so deceptive. Their true nature, their true beliefs are hidden below Christian words. And Jude is here warning Christians, be discerning, pay attention, don't let false teachers come in and deceive your people. This lesson, however, is reinforcing the idea that the Adventist reader is supposed to be wary of anybody who comes in to try to warn them against Adventism. They've turned it completely inside out and upside down. They're misusing this text, suggesting that Adventists have the truth, and any Christian who comes in, any former Adventist who might come in and say, "You are reading the Bible wrong. You are reading through an interpretive grid. You're not even aware you have." They're preloaded to resist that because they will understand any kind of opposition to Adventism is a false teacher. But you can see in context that Jude is warning Christians against people like Adventists. There's another text that's badly misused. This occurs in Thursday's lesson. Now, what's so interesting here is that these three texts are given in the lesson on Thursday, and the reader is asked to read them, and then this question is asked, what assurances did these promises give you personally? Now, these three texts are amazing. They're some of the texts that we frequently use, we who have left Adventism, to say, this is what the Bible says about our salvation. But here, Mark Finley is taking these texts and sticking them inside the great controversy worldview, and again, twisting their meaning through the grid of Ellen White's interpretations. Here are the three texts, John 5:24, John 11:25 to 26, and 1 John 5:11 to 16. Now we're going to only read John 5:24, but I will just say that the John 11 passage is where Jesus says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will never die, and he who dies will live even if he dies." And the 1 John 5:11 to 16 passage is the passage that says, "He who has the Son has the life, and by this we may know that we have the life, if we have the Son of God." John 5:24 says this, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come into judgment, but has passed out of death into life." Now I ask you, any Adventist who reads that and then is asked, what does this tell you personally about your assurance? What is an Adventist going to say? Adventists do not believe that they pass immediately into eternal life if they believe Jesus. They don't understand, first of all, that they're dead and don't have eternal life. They don't believe that they're born condemned. So if they're asked about their assurance, an Adventist really doesn't have anywhere to go with that question except to say, well, if I sin, I probably have to admit that I've fallen out of salvation and I have to ask for forgiveness and come back into salvation. And if I keep doing that every day, if I keep accepting Jesus every day, and I've heard them say this, if I accept him every day, then that day I'm saved. Or if I accept him and then confess when I sin, then I'm saved until then. It's always a matter for an Adventist of confessing and coming back into salvation, falling out, coming back in. But you know what? You can't fall out of being born again. Adventism does not teach the new birth. This John 5:24 passage is teaching that if we believe Jesus, if we believe that he came, sent by the Father, bore our sins on the cross, died, was buried, was risen on the third day, and broke our curse of death, that we have from that moment eternal life because we come to life spiritually. We who are dead in sin become alive, spiritually alive, never to die. Our bodies will be resurrected for eternal life. We can know this. Adventism doesn't teach you can know this. They don't teach that you pass from death to life the moment you believe. It's all metaphorized. It's all figurative. It's all repeat, repeat, repeat. Do it again. Do it again. But that's not what this passage says. Do you see how sinister it is to put this text inside the framework of the great controversy interpreted by the grid of Ellen White, which isn't telling the truth about Scripture, but is redefining it? It inoculates the Adventist against the gospel. And I just want to say, as we end our discussion of this week's lessons, this is very serious. In this lesson, where Mark Finley is presenting the framework for understanding Adventism's central focus of eschatology, a strange, made-up notion of day-for-a-year principle, which is nowhere suggested in Scripture, but which twists everything we read about prophecy into something that's not recognizable in context, in this lesson, the heart of the gospel is also twisted. The good news that if we believe in Jesus and believe in the one who sent him, we pass at that moment from death to life. The Adventist won't understand that. And I appeal to you. Have you understood it? Have you understood that you are born dead in sin and the wrath of God remains on you? John 3:39. I appeal to you. Don't take my word for it. Go pick up your Bible. Go read John 3 through John 5. Read these passages that describe the new birth, that explain our natural condition, that explain what happens when we believe in Jesus. Jesus came to set us free from the lies and confusion of false understandings of the Bible. He came to set us free from Ellen White. He came to set us free from false prophets and from those who propagate the notions she gave in her writings. Go to the Bible. Ask God to show you what he actually said. Ask him to take away that invisible veil of Ellen White's interpretations and ask him to show you the truth of your need for him and the truth of what Jesus has done. And trust him today. Believe him. Pass from death to life by believing in the Lord Jesus. There is nothing to compare with the freedom we find when we have Jesus alone and we can let go all of that prophetic confusion left by the false prophet Ellen White. Trust Jesus.